responsibility towards one another. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 1 to chapter 6, verse 2. Paul now directs his attention to giving Timothy some general rules governing our behaviour and responsibility towards the old and young of both sexes. And interesting to note that there'd already been a change taking place in society in the general concern of behaviour and responsibility to the old. Plato, as early as 100 BC, was teaching that we should treat the older person as our parent and the younger one as our brother. What Paul does here by the Holy Spirit is he lifts the teaching to, from a humanistic point of view, to a profoundly spiritual level. Because of our relationship in Christ has made the older people our fathers and mothers in the faith, and the younger ones our brothers and sisters in the faith, Paul sees that because of Christ, a family relationship has now been formed, while the world sees it as something to be obtained. Dale Carnegie is the grandfather of all people skills. In 1937, he published his first book on people skills titled How to Win Friends and Influence People. It was an overnight success, eventually selling 15 million copies, and is just as useful today as it was when it was first published. Why? It's because Dale Carnegie had an understanding of human nature that will never be outdated. He teaches these skills through underlining principles of dealing with people so that they feel important and appreciated. He also emphasizes the fundamental techniques of working with people without making them feel manipulated. It's very important in any leader, let alone a leader in the church who has to deal with so many different types of people from not so many different backgrounds, to have a good people skill at this time. Section A, interacting with various age groups. Chapter 5, verses 1 to 2. As a pastor, Timothy had to deal with a lot of different people from different cultural backgrounds and age groups, and confronting them with the truth and reprimanding them when necessary. It's never easy reprimanding people, especially if you have to do it in a gracious manner. It is even made even more complicated by the church's situation, because we believe that we are a close-knit group of people who over the years of our salvation has either lost contact with our old friends before we were Christians or been rejected by them. This close association tends to erase the common courtesies we are to give to one another. Because of this, we either shrink from correcting someone who strayed from the faith, or we blurt it out in a voice of anger, fearing that they might try to denigrate us and put us down. To help Timothy through these problems, Paul sets before him general people skills on how to handle four types of people who may need correction. The first group are older men. Now, the word elder that's used here applies not to the church officials by the same name, but to the older members of the congregation. Here, Paul deals with the frustration and loneliness and isolation that Timothy was experiencing of having to deal with older people who were constantly challenged everything that Timothy did and say. Now, Paul tells Timothy that if he should see an older man straying from the truth or challenging his authority, he's not to rebuke them. Now, the Greek word here for rebuke literally means to strike with blows, but here it's used figuratively, and it means that he is not to attack someone or to ride roughshod over someone with words or to express strong disapproval by rebuking, reproaching, or denouncing them publicly. Now, either Timothy had actually done this or that he just felt like doing it, we don't know. More likely the latter. Timothy's experience is not unlike that of many young pastors taking over the senior role of a local church. Paul counsels Timothy to temper his frustration and to treat these older men as fathers and to exalt them as a father. Now, the word exalt here means to encourage, which must have been quite a challenge for Timothy, as the scriptures seem to indicate that Timothy's natural father had very little input into his life. The only role model of fatherhood Timothy had was Paul himself. We must understand that Paul is not saying that the older men can do as they please in the church just because of their age. No, rather, Paul is saying they must be corrected, but it must be done in the same humility, love, and tenderness as if they were Timothy's own father. Mark Twain made this comment about his father. He said, "When I was a boy of 14 years of age, my father was so ignorant I could hardly stand to have the old man around. But when I got to 21, I was astonished how much he'd learned in 7 years. You know, it's amazing how 7 years in the ministry can change it for the better, our opinion of older people. The second group that Timothy had to deal with was young men. Even though Timothy may be called to correct the younger men, he must not lose sight of the spirit of equality, but must work with younger men as brothers of the same level. Admiral Horatio Nelson, the supreme commander of the British fleet that defeated the French in the Battle of Trafalgar in 1805, had an amazing ability to bring people alongside himself in close confidence and colleagues in order to achieve a definite goal. His skill as a leader enabled him to bind the officers together in what was called a band of brothers par excellence, to achieve a common goal are still studied today by young naval and other military officers. Nelson's style of leadership involved creating a partnership and loyalty within a close-knit group of carefully chosen individuals and increasing that partnership by observing and inviting strong potential followers to join the partnership of the Band of Brothers. The term Band of Brothers seems to have been introduced into naval language after Nelson demonstrated his skills as a leader following the Nile and Copenhagen campaign, in which each time he led his fleet to victory. It is used to describe a real sense of comradeship, shared mindset, and the principle of forward learning and a natural tendency for action. Leading up to each campaign, weather and circumstances permitting, Nelson would invite upon his flagship all his officers to share an informal meal. Now, these informal meetings not only provided an opportunity for close fellowship and stimulating conversation amongst his officers, but also an opportunity for Nelson to reveal his thinking to his captains, a chance to discuss tactics and to explore ideas. Nelson was a team leader who understood that leadership as a partnership did not distract from his role as a leader, but in fact enhanced it. Timothy was to learn to do the same, drawing young men around him as colleagues. A band of brothers united against the powers of darkness, which did not undermine his authority, but rather enhanced it and made the church at Ephesus a formidable force against the gates of hell, which could not stand against the church. The third group is the older women. Again, it refers to older women of the congregation. Timothy is to respect them as he would his own mother, and if correction is needed, is to be done as a loving adult son would deal with his mother, whose conduct did not support the Christian faith. Acting in this manner, he would naturally solicit their prayers, and just as his own mother Eunice and grandmother Lois supported him and prayed for him, so would the older women. Many a young pastor has found their strong alliance and support come from this group. The fourth group is younger women, and Timothy is to treat them with all purity as he would his own sister. Paul is well aware of the transfer of affections that could take place between people, in particular in pastoral care. Such thought patterns and actions of purity on Timothy's part would avoid suspicion, scandal, and sin. We must also note that there is no sense of superiority or ranking in Paul's words to Timothy about these young women, as he says that they are his sisters. And in a family, brothers and sisters are equal. And as they grow older and move to adulthood, the sense of equality amongst the siblings grows stronger. Like the young men of the church, they are part of the band of brothers, or we might say band of sisters, and they have just as an important role to play in the growth and advancement of the church for the advancement of the kingdom of God. Section B, Widows, chapter 5, verses 3 to 16. In Australia, we have an organization which is a charity called Legacy, which provides financial and social services to Australian families of armed forces whose spouse or parents have suffered incapacity or died in service for the country. Legacy cares for over 100 widows, 1,900 children and dependents throughout Australia. Legacy has its origin in the First World War. General Sir John Gillibrand and Lieutenant General Sir Stanley Savage set up the organisation in 1923 to help returning soldiers establish businesses. However, in 1925, it was suggested that this organisation, Legacy, should look into caring for the children of deceased servicemen. Now this proposal was accepted, and legacy found its soul. With that legacy of caring continuing to this day, legacy recognizes both the legacy of freedom that the armed forces of this nation provided for us, and also the ongoing legacy which widows and their children can contribute to this nation. Timothy and the church is not to overlook the ongoing legacy and growth that the widows and their children provide. And we are also to care for them as we would for our own mothers, grandmothers, sons, daughters, nieces, and nephews. Section 1, Widows in Need, chapter 5, verses 3 to 8. In the ancient world, a widow received no such help. When a woman's husband died, all of her husband's properties and assets were passed to the children and not to his wife. And the widow had no rights or assets. There was no government assistance for the widow, no such organizations in the Roman Empire as legacy to assist her, and there was no source of income. So she either was forced to return to her father's home or to totally rely on people's charity. In this section, Paul deals with the Christian's responsibility in the care of widows. Not only does he deal with the church's responsibility, but also the responsibility of the relatives of the widow, as well as the conduct of widows. This responsibility was further increased because women could not always find ready employment of an honorable kind. In this passage, Paul actually deals with three kinds of widows. 1.1, Godly Widows, verses 3 and 5. During the reign of Queen Victoria, a London doctor visited a 72-year-old lady named Mary Vincent. Her husband had abandoned her some years earlier. She was poor and lived in a very humble surroundings. She was undernourished and had neither warm clothes nor wood for fire. The doctor couldn't believe that her friends had allowed her to live like this. When he asked about it, Maria said she had no friends. Now later in the discussion, she corrected herself. She admitted that there might be one, but she was sure that she had forgotten about it. Now the doctor pressed her for the identity of the friend, and finally Maria told her that it was the queen herself. She said that the two of them had been childhood friends. Well, the doctor left not sure that he would believe Maria, but when he got home, he wrote a letter to Queen Victoria relating the incident. A few days later, he received a letter from the Queen. The story was true. The Queen had not forgotten. Enclosed in the letter was enough money to provide for all of Maria's assets. For the remaining of her years of her life, Maria Vincent lived comfortably as a friend of the Queen. Now, Paul says in verse 3 that we are to honor widows. And the word honor in the Greek, which appears to convey not only the normal idea of respect, but also material support. The word widow means a woman who's bereaved and deprived of her husband, hence without any material support. So here Paul is speaking of a woman who is all alone in this world. She has no husband or grown-up children or grandchildren to care for her. She is totally desolate. To this type of widow, the church has a responsibility to provide care. We are to treat them like Queen Victoria treated Maria, as a close friend. The widow is not without responsibilities regarding her conduct. As first, she is to put her trust in God. That is, she is not to look to others to supply her need, but fix her hopes on God alone for her strength and refuge. And secondly, she is to be seen to live a godly life in the same manner in which Anna, the prophetess, was found daily in the temple worshiping God in Luke chapter 2. 1.2, the widow with children and grandchildren, verses 4 and 8. In these verses, Paul tells us that if a widow has children or grandchildren, that it is their responsibility to care for her and not the church's. Now, by nature, children are often more disinclined to provide for a needy parent. According to the Dutch proverb, it's more frequently easier for one poor father to bring up 10 children than 10 rich children to provide for one poor father. Paul says that children and grandchildren should first learn to show piety at home, which means two things. First, they must learn to practice religion at home before practicing outside of the house. And secondly, it should be done in gladness and in the spirit of love and a token of appreciation for what they received from their parents when they were young. Paul says that the children who do not care for their aged parent deny the faith and are worse than infidel or a pagan. Now this may seem strange that Paul would write this until we look at the Greek law at that time, which stated from the time of Solon, a Athen lawgiver, that sons and daughters were not only morally but legally bound to support their parents, and anyone who refused that duty lost civil rights. It's really unthinkable that the Christian standard of morality should lag behind the ancient pagan standards. 1.3, the merry widow, verses 6 and 7. This person is a widow who shows no convincing evidence that her trust is in God, but on the contrary is involved in sensual living. Whether she has children or not, she has forfeited all her rights to the claim of a widow in need of help and in respect to needy material care. The church should treat her as dead. Of course, the church's position must change if she finds Christ as Savior and shows a godly life. Paul tells Timothy in verse 7 that the reason why he has set down such a standard is because to indiscriminately include widows amongst those whom are under the care of the church would do the reputation of the church no good. The honor of the church depends upon the church's proper care of godly widows and the Christians' properly care of their aged parents. Section 2, Widows as Christian Workers, chapter 5, verses 9 to 10. In order to understand Paul's thoughts, we must understand a few things about this passage. First, the qualifications and duties stated in these verses do not necessarily apply to the widow's future work, as they could have referred to the previous experience as a church worker. It would hardly seem likely that a woman of 60 years could have maintained the continuous pace of such activities, particularly when 60 years at that time was a very advanced age. Second, we have the word taken, which literally means enrollment of a soldier. Judging by the mention of the age 60 and Paul's reference in verse 14 of young widows remarrying again, the enrollment seems to imply, in order to serve the Lord, a woman entering into the order of widows at the age of 60 pledged herself to remain unmarried. Now, all commentators agree that Paul is not setting a minimum age of 60 of being the age for which a woman can be assisted as a widow. Paul sets out seven qualifications for the widow's ability to serve in the church. First, she must have been the wife of one man. Now, this does not mean that she should not have been married before, for Paul speaks of young widows getting married again in verse 14. Or that she has not been divorced, but rather it means that she must have been faithful to her husband while he was living, or she was living with him. Secondly, she should have a reputation for good works. Doing good is not a single act. Rather, it's a continuous way of life that benefits everyone, including yourself, and all Christians should be known for doing good. Volunteers contribute socially and economically to their community. Volunteering, regardless of its aim, boosts a volunteer's self-esteem and develops personal skills of the volunteer. Paul knows how important it is for widows to have developed good self-esteem, as it will help her overcome many obstacles that she would face in her life on her own. And this is why he encourages them to be involved in good works. People who are self-absorbed are easy prey to Satan and false teachers. Thirdly, she could have brought up children. Now, this caring of children should not be limited to her own children. For if it did, it would cancel out a widow who could not have children. In the ancient world, when a child was born, they were brought and laid at the father's feet. If the father picked up the child, he acknowledged the child as his, and saying that he would take care of that child and be responsible for that child. If he turned his back and walked away from the child was literally then thrown on the rubbish dump as a piece of disregarded or unwanted rubbish. Unwanted children were often collected by some very unscrupulous characters who raised the girls as prostitutes and the boys as gladiators and slaves. Trafficking of children still goes on today. In the 21st century, research carried out by UNICEF and other organizations, it was found that most cases of trafficking of children is deliberately promoted by the children's family. From a combination of ignorance, desperation, exploitation, and even customs. Now, in the context of the passage, in the ancient world, caring for children would include caring for orphans whose parents had died or at birth had disregarded them. And in the 21st century, it would also include the above, as well as supporting such organizations as World Vision that save children from exploitation and the hands of child traffickers. Fourthly, the widow should have lodged strangers. Most commentators feel that the reference to strangers refers to traveling Christians moving from place to place, either as itinerant preachers or persecuted Christians seeking shelter. In today's circumstance, it would include the care of refugees escaping religious persecution, and in general, it means that she has fulfilled the duty of a good hostess. Fifthly, Paul says that the widow is to wash the saints' feet, which means that in the care of those in need, she has done it with a humble attitude, not drawing attention to herself. In fact, the actions is restricted to the saints, makes it an action that demonstrates her godliness, devotion to Christ, and desire to obey Christ's commands to unselfishly serve the body of Christ. Sixthly, she should have relieved the afflicted, which means that she would have visited those in need and ministered to them in some material way. And finally, she has diligently followed every good work, which means that she's lived according to the precepts of the gospel and did the Lord's work with all her heart. Jesus said these words in Matthew's gospel, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." The life of a Christian widow and the lives of all Christians are to be lives that glorify God. Section 3, Young Widows, chapter 5, verses 11 to 15. Verses 11 to 12, Paul further explains why in verse 9 he has set the age limit of a woman to take the vow of service to Christ as being 60 years. It is because if a younger woman who is eligible for relief when she was in genuine distress undertook such an obligation of service to the church as did the older woman and then got married or designed to get married, she would now be disloyal to Christ because she's cast off her first love, that is her vow or pledge to serve Christ. Now, Paul certainly understands human nature here. We see in his words to grow wanton, which in the Greek actually means to feel sexual desire. Also, the word is used to describe a young ox trying to escape from a yoke. Paul realizes and understands that the young widow would not wish to be tied to church duties if further opportunities came for marriage, and that in a pursuit for normal happiness and companionship, the widow was then caught between two desires, either a breaking her vow to God or to remain discontent in fulfilling a vow. Whichever one she chose, it would be dishonoring to God and to herself. We see that Paul, by the Holy Spirit, set the minimum age of 60 in verse 9 for the vow of pledge of service so the young widow could escape such personal condemnation, which may even lead to eventually turning her back on the church and God. God, in his great love for us, does not want any of us to be put in such a position that Satan can take advantage of a sincere but emotional decision that we have made in the past. We must be careful to point out that the young widow, if she does take the vow of service, does not forego the church's care for her. Verses 13 to 15. In these verses, Paul becomes more explicit in his reason for not having younger women undertake the pledge of service. He knows that once younger widow's grief is over the loss of her husband is past, she will become restless because he has or possesses youthful vigor, which includes the normal sexual impulses. Paul also knows that if such youthful vigor is not caged up, the young widow will eventually misuse her visitation ministry or today's social network in which she lives. And what had been an opportunity of relief of the afflicted had become an opportunity to gossip and to betray confidence and trust. Paul actually goes further and says that she will learn to be idle. And in the Greek, it actually, in the broad sense, means that she will make idleness a profession of life. This will lead to two other sins. First being that she will become a mischief maker or tattletale, particularly because she's young enough to be in the social stream of things. Yet Paul points out that this profession of idleness will lead to a more sinister thing, which is becoming a busybody, saying things which she ought not in verse 13. The word busybody in the Greek comes from the Greek word which describes books or writings which contain spells and magic arts and acts. the word is used in Acts 19:19 to describe the magic books that the Christians brought and burned. Also, the practice of saying things which they ought not refers to words used in magic spells, incantations, as well as the occult saying. Therefore, it appears that Paul is saying that if a young widow binds herself in the vow of service, therefore cancelling out her opportunity to remarry, she is liable to fall into the sin of making idleness a profession of life and while undertaking her household visitings, which resort to charms, incantations, and magical formulas in dealing with the sick and other needs in the house. We must realize that Paul is not dealing here with mere speculation, for it appears that he's speaking from experience. Archaeologists have been surprised at how many charms and incantations and formulas are found in Christian tombs of that time. Paul is dealing with the very real danger at that time, a danger which we also face today given the rise of the occult. Therefore, Paul encourages the general principle that a young widow should feel free to remarry as she has the opportunity to do so. He goes on further to indicate that if she desires to remarry, have children, and manage a home, it's not out of the will of God. Paul sees remarriage for a young widow within the bonds of the church as a means of closing any loopholes of which Satan may take advantage in order to slander the church, and he's well aware that some young widows have already undertaken the vow of service to the Lord and have broken it because of youthful vigor. Also, because of their guilt and condemnation, they have forsaken the church and Christ, and some have followed after Satan and given themselves to immoral conduct. Paul is a true pastor who understands human nature and does everything he can to guide and to care those under his care. For he knows that God knows our names and does not wish that any should perish. And as a leader, we are to protect the church from all attacks of Satan. Section 4, further thoughts on the financial care of widows, verse 16. This verse is somewhat difficult to understand at first, yet it's generally agreed among scholars that is an interjection where Paul has remembered something about the care of widows that he's forgotten to mention in verses 3 and 5. And that is that the care of widows without children or grandchildren, which is not restricted to the church alone. If any man or woman has the means of material or financial assistance in their care, the church would much appreciate it. Some translations have left the word man out, for it would be proper for a man to have a household of widows. And yet it must be pointed out that the verse in no way suggests housing, only of material or financial assisting. So we see there's no reason why the giving of money and aid to widows should be restricted to only men. Women can also assist in this area. Section C, pastors, chapter 5, verses 17 to 20. Verses 17 and 18, Paul's attention again is focused on the officials of the church, the elders who rule well. The word elder and pastor are interchangeable here. The word well in the Greek refers to someone who's undertaken a task in an excellent and commendable way. Paul says that such a one should not be taken for granted by the congregation, especially those who labor in the word, which is preaching, and doctrine, which is teaching. And the word labor here means to work hard, to toil, to grow weary, and to labor to the point of weariness. And these are the ones that Paul says deserves double honor. And the word honor in the Greek is timai, and it carries the idea of payment. Coupled with the word double, gives a clear understanding that all payment is to be given amply and generously. To support what Paul said, he draws from an illustration found in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy 25. In their greed to have all the grain, evidently the cruel pagans would at times muzzle the ox so it could not eat any grain while they drove it repeatedly across the threshing floor, crushing out the corn until it dropped with exhaustion. God had forbidden the Jews to conduct such a practice, as a reward for its labor, the ox should be left muzzle-free and allowed to eat as much grain as it wanted. It's the same with the congregation. It should not be greedy like the pagans, seeking its own gain while driving its ministers to weary exhaustion. Rather, they should supply amply for the minister's need as he or she labors amongst them. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 7 to 9, we read that Paul, in addition to using the same illustration of an ox crushing out the grain, describes a pastor as a soldier, a laborer, and a shepherd. worthy of wages. He tells us that a minister is like a soldier fighting in the battle of the Lord. In the world, no soldier defends his or her country at their own expenses. So why should it be any different for such a spiritual soldier as our pastor? The pastor is also like a laborer in a vineyard, planting and watering and pruning. And in the natural, such worthy laborers were allowed to eat of the fruit. So why should it be any different for the church? Finally, a pastor is like a shepherd, watching over us, protecting us against the wolves, and feeding us with the food from the word of God. In the natural, a good shepherd was allowed to clothe himself with the wool of the sheep and to drink the goat's milk. So why should a pastor be denied the bare essentials of life? It stands to reason that an ox who is able to eat the grain while working, and a soldier is equipped, and a laborer and a shepherd who are well looked after, will last longer, remain more committed to their position, therefore being more productive. And so it is with a pastor who is relieved of financial burden and worry, will be more productive in his or her church. Here Paul is not only speaking about the monetary value, but about the need to express appreciation, a word of encouragement to our pastors and leaders. E.W. Howe stated that the great humiliation in life is to work hard on something from which you expect a great appreciation and then fail to get it. Too many pastors suffer from a broken spirit simply because they don't feel appreciated for their tireless service. Paul knew what commonly known amongst human behaviorists, that appreciation promotes loving behavior and commitment from those who feel appreciated. A word of genuine appreciation can heal the spirit and reinvigorate the soul to perform outstanding service. Verses 19 to 20. Paul realizes that a pastor is always open to malicious and slanderous attacks, especially from those who resent him disciplining them. So he sets forth in the church by the Holy Spirit a scriptural from Deuteronomy and a Jewish principle of justice, which is that no one can condemn on the evidence of one witness. The wrong actions must be seen by two or more witnesses before the charge can be laid. Paul continues that if such a charge can be proved by two or more witnesses that a pastor is living in sin, that correction is to be done in the church and not before the world. Unfortunately, this verse has been used by some church officials to protect church leaders or members who have perpetrated a criminal offense against a child or an adult or committed fraud. Any such charges or crimes must be reported to the authorities as soon as they come to light. The church has a God-given role to protect the innocent and the vulnerable. Section D, Timothy's own behavior, chapter 5, verses 21 to 25, verses 21 and 22. Paul charges Timothy to observe all his instructions without prejudice or favoritism, for if he doesn't, it will spell the ruin of the church at Ephesus. Paul reminds Timothy that all his actions are being observed by God, Jesus Christ, and elect angels. It's a further reminder to Timothy that he is responsible to God for all his actions, and it should resemble the elect angels in obedience. This is particularly important in choosing leaders or pastors. Great care should be taken in the selection of a person for such an office, and no hasty judgments are to be made. Timothy is instructed not to lay hands on anyone hastily. Here Paul is speaking concerning the ceremony of or ordination of an officer or a pastor, at which times there is often an impartation of spiritual gifts to that person to undertake the office. Now Paul warns Timothy that before any person is ordained, their qualifications should be carefully considered and thoroughly investigated, or else Timothy and the other members of the board who will share in the responsibility, to some degree, the guilt and sinful effects of an unwise choice. Paul says not to share in others people's sins. And though it's not said, it's certainly implied that if the ordination body takes every precaution available in selecting a pastor or a leader, then they are not responsible to God for a sinful lapse or of that straying leader or pastor. Now verse 23. This verse appears to be in brackets, for it's out of context with what has been said and what is about to be said. Paul has for a moment left aside the busy affairs of church administration to give a bit of loving advice to Timothy about his health. It appears in the text that Timothy suffered from some sort of stomach illness and that he had abstained from taking wine, which was at that time employed as a medical agent, and only drank water lest people thought that he had been given to wine. Now, Paul urges Timothy to take some wine. Not much, but only enough for the purpose of good physical health. Paul in no way is encouraging wine or alcohol to be used outside of this purpose. The use of wine was prominent then largely due to the fact that local water often was so contaminated that it was unfit for human consumption and frequently causing cholera and other waterborne diseases. Now verses 24 to 25. There's a Chinese proverb that says, "Don't be over self-confident with your first impressions of people." In these verses, Paul returns to the subject of ordination. He tells Timothy, and also us, that first impressions are not always reliable and often deceptive. Even though the sins of some are obvious and therefore exclude them from ordination, and there are other people who are unfit to take public office who have an uncanny knack of hiding their true selves from others. And when they are finally found out, well, it's too late. Just as a worthy people are often overlooked because they do not bring their good deeds out into the limelight for all to see, so evil people will often go unnoticed because they do not bring their bad deeds to the surface. Timothy, like all church elders, must use discernment when ordaining someone to office, as attractive personalities can mask the true intent of the heart. People's personality are like icebergs. You only get to see one-tenth and the other nine-tenths are hidden. What is also interesting is that icebergs are constantly rolling over in the ocean as their bottom melts, revealing different formations. This phenomenon has proved to be very dangerous to ships in shipping lanes as they are on the outlook for a particular shaped iceberg, but it's rolled over and now looks very different. Evil people have the same tendency. In order to deceive people, they constantly change their appearance. Timothy and also we ourselves must give sufficient time for the true character of each one recommended for ordination to rise to the service before ordaining them as a minister or an officer within the church. Section E, employees and employers, chapter 6 verses 1 to 6. This topic, like the topic of false teachers, is repeatedly dealt with both by Paul and Peter throughout the New Testament. Why is this? It's because most of us spend more time working than doing anything else. Often as Christians, we view our jobs as a necessary evil, but God views our jobs differently. God created us for work. Labor is part of God's intention for us. God views our jobs as service to Him, as being a daily action that should glorify Him as much as our worship on Sunday and our private devotions. The words in this verse are linked back to the responsibility of a Christian widow shown in verse 10, which was to have diligently followed after every good work, and the words of Christ in Matthew's Gospel chapter 5 verse 16 that says, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." Paul first addresses Christian slaves or Christian employees working for non-Christian masters or non-Christian employer. This type of slave would have made up a large portion of the Christian slaves in the church at that time. Paul tells them that they must not use their newfound liberty in Christ as a reason to be less faithful in their service to their master or employer, because such conduct would call the master or employer to blaspheme God and the gospel. Paul also points out how vulnerable their position is by reminding them that they were under the yoke, which means that their master had absolute power over them, just like a yoked animal. To the master in the ancient world, the slave was no more status than an animal. He could have them beaten, killed, or sold, or sent away, and any one of these things would have a dire consequences on the slave's family. In verse 2, Paul's attention is drawn to the Christian slave or employee working for a Christian master or an employer. The problem was this: in the church, the slave was on the same status as their master, but in the master's house, he was inferior to the master. Because of this, many Christian slaves began to despise or look down on their Christian master's experience, feeling that their master's Christian experience was suspect because they had not given them freedom. Now, Paul reprimands such thinking from a Christian employee for believing that just because their master or employer was a Christian, that social distinctions had been abolished. The fact that their master or employee was a believer, a beloved brother in Christ, and also shared in the blessings of salvation should be a good enough reason for the slave to give their Christian masters or employers faithful service. Although in the 21st century we don't have slaves, the principle remains the same. Just because our employer is a Christian does not release us from the responsibility of doing a good day's work for them. Conclusion. As Christians, we are responsible for one another. And numerous verses in the New Testament gives us a command about what we should do for one another. Jesus gave us the well-known command in John's Gospel to love one another. We are to be devoted to one another in brotherly love, in honoring and giving preference to one another, as seen in Romans, through love, service, and one another, seen in Galatians, and always pursuing the good for yourself and for all in 1 Thessalonians. Helen Keller, the deaf and blind author and political activist, lecturer, and committed Christian, said these words, "Until the great mass of people shall be filled with a sense of responsibility for each other's welfare, social justice will never be obtained." Paul shows very clear that social justice begins in the church and flows through the church into the community. Helen Keller also said these words, "I do not want peace which passes understanding. I want understanding which brings peace." The whole idea of being people skilled is knowing or finding how to bring out the best in others in any situation rather than the worst. Dale Carnegie's book, How to Win Friends and Influence People, brought harmony and peace in the workplace. Paul's instruction in this chapter not only brings peace and harmony in the church, but also restores and keeps those for whom we care and lead within the tender arms of our great shepherd and savior, Jesus Christ.